Good evening, and welcome to another edition of Around the Town. I'm Ken Boxer, and we have a very exciting show this half hour. In fact, it's just, I can't believe the guest that we have during this half hour, White House spokesman Marlin Fitzwater, here live in the studio on KCTV's Around the Town. Welcome to Around the Town, Marlin.
Thank you, Ken. Nice to be here.
Thank you so very much for coming. Your job responsibility as the spokesman for the White House has to be enormous. The responsibilities that you have day in and day out. How do you get through a day?
Well, it's really not as bad as it seems. The key is being prepared, knowing what's going on in the world, and having a good staff around you that makes sure that you know what's happening. But it is a long day at the White House, and the press corps is big and vociferous and interested and demanding. But it's also a very exciting kind of day.
What is that day like? You start in the morning, what happens?
Well, we start early in the morning, first of all, to scan the newspapers and find out what the press is interested in that day. Then we take a look at...
Wait. Before you get to that part, you wake up, get out of bed. What's the first thought that happens right before you know you're going to head to the White House?
Well, the first thought is one of fear when you know that you're going to pick up the paper on the front door and find out how bad are the things you said yesterday. And so I always live in fear that Fitzwater says something stupid again on the front page of the Washington Post. So that's the first thing.
Okay, so you've looked at the newspapers, then what happens here?
Well, I live in Virginia, so I have about a half-hour commute to the White House. And as I said, we go through the papers, and then I prepare a memorandum for all of the White House staff and for the president that outlines the major news stories of the day and what we will have to respond to. Then we have a senior staff meeting in which all of the president's staff discuss the issues of the day, as well as his meetings, what he is going to be saying to various groups, and what kind of press coverage we want. And so the first morning or two, first hour or two of every morning is really planning, getting the president ready for his day, making sure he has the backup papers he needs, and making sure that all of us are focused on the events of that day.
Now, are you calling the president on the telephone when you're at the White House or at home and saying, hey, did you see what was written about us yesterday? Or what's it like? What are you doing?
Well, I don't call him too often unless it's something pretty dramatic. That happens occasionally. But for the most part, when he comes into the office, I'll catch him between meetings or when he first comes in and say, gee, the press says that you had a terrible night. Tell me, was it good or not? And he is very easy to work with. The president's wonderful in terms of telling me what's going on and how he feels about things. And so he makes the job very easy from that standpoint.
So on a day-to-day basis, you're in contact with the president from day-to-day?
Well, yes. You have to remember that in the White House, the president has a staff of probably 10 or 15 people who are really in charge of his daily schedule and organize events for him and that sort of thing. And so we are all around him during the day. Of course, just as you would be around the manager of this station, for example, during the day. So it becomes a very collegial kind of working relationship.
What is that relationship, though, with the president? Is it a cordial one with you? Are you telling jokes? Are you serious all the time? What is that relationship from a day-to-day basis?
Well, the interesting thing about working for a president is that you never forget he's the president, first of all. There is always a slight wall there, a wall that says, you know, this man has the power that rules the country in terms of managing the government. On the other hand, there's also a familiarity, and there is a lot of easygoing jokes before and after meetings. The president's a great storyteller, and often we'll do our business for 20 minutes or half an hour, and the president will end the meeting with the story he's heard. So it's kind of a combination of formality, respect for the office, and at the same time, casual informality.
You are the voice of the president. What's that like?
Well, it's not as hard as it seems in the sense that, for one thing, President Reagan has been in politics for 20 years or more. People know what he believes, what he thinks, and I know what he believes and what he thinks. And a big part of my job is interpreting what the president would say or how he would react to various events simply because he's not available. I mean, the whole purpose of a spokesman really is simply because the president doesn't have time to do it himself. And obviously the press would like it, and And I'm sure the president would like it if he had nothing to do all day but talk to reporters. So mainly I just have to know what the president is thinking about various issues.
When you inherited the job, it was during a period of time when it was pretty hot in the White House, so to speak, with the Iran-Contra. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people said, oh, poor Marlin, he's, you know, no one would want your job at this point, because when Larry Speaks was leaving, you came in. Uh-huh. What was it like in the White House at that time?
Well, it was a little strange in the sense that I had been a deputy press secretary to Larry Speaks from 83 to 85, and then went with Vice President Bush as his press secretary, then came back then in February of 87. The Iran-Contra story had just really broken and gotten underway, and that did make a big difference. There was a lot of pressure on Don Regan, the chief of staff at that point, to leave. And so that caused a somewhat difficult situation inside the White House. And there was more turmoil than I had remembered, certainly, in 83 and 84. On the other hand, it was a great challenge, too. In many ways, it was the best way to start a new job, because we didn't quite know what was happening. Investigations were just started. The president had ordered the Tower Board report to look into Iran-Contra. He had ordered full cooperation with all the authorities. And there were just a lot of things happening. And
but for you personally, how were you handling it in terms of when you went home? what were you doing?
I just walked in and said, you know, first of all, don't talk about what I don't know about. And don't answer questions I don't know the answers to. As long as I kept that in mind, I was in pretty good shape. And what I tried to do was to be as honest with the press as I could be. But at the same token, I wanted to make sure that the White House didn't end up in the role of investigating itself. I mean, the president was, I think, very wise when he first discovered this situation with their diversion of funds. He went to the press, he went to the public, and he got outside investigations organized to look into the whole affair. And I thought it was important for me to maintain that posture so that the American people could know that it was a third party that looked into this and not the White House. So while the White House press corps was always after me to try to answer questions about who did what to whom and so forth, for one thing, I really didn't know those answers. Mm-hmm. And two, I thought it was important that we not try to answer them, that those be left to the independent parties.
Looking back on it now, do you think you did the right thing in the way you handled it, in terms of your position?
Well, let's just say I don't know how I would do it any different. And I'm pleased with the outcome. I mean, I tried to maintain some civility, but in a situation where there was a lot of tense feelings between the press and the White House. I tried to be as honest and open as I could. And above all, I believed in the president. And I just latched on to him as my rock, so to speak, and said the president did the right thing and knew what he was doing, and beyond that, the rest of this can swirl around us. And I get on balance, I'm pleased with the way it all worked out.
The relationship you have with the president, does he ever ask you for advice? And when he does, if so, does he accept it and does he ever use it?
Well, he asked about advice on dealing with the press. Things like, for example, who's coming to see me, what do I say on a certain issue, or maybe what have we said. One of the things is that I brief the press every morning, and so the president doesn't always know what's been announced and what hasn't been announced because of all the things that come up in the course of a press briefing. So he may ask me, you know, have we announced a new appointment yet, and what have we said publicly on this matter, and so forth. But for the most part, the president tells me what to say.
What is the relationship that you have with the press, the White House press corps, that is?
Well, I think I have a good relationship with the press corps. First of all, I like them. They're good people. The press are good people. And White House reporters are as good as they are in the business. They wouldn't be in the White House if they weren't. And sometimes they press me to the breaking point almost, and sometimes it gets a little irritating to get 30 people asking exactly the same questions. On the other hand, I respect their right to do that, and I just try to be patient. And I try to remember one thing Larry Speaks told me before he left, which was, you don't have to explain what you don't say. And so I try to keep from saying what I don't want to explain?
Briefly, Larry Speaks has written a book, and in that book we all know about that he had said something that, quoting the president, saying it was a quote, but it really wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
How'd that affect you?
Well, that was an unfortunate episode because I worked for Larry, and I don't share that belief that that's an appropriate thing to do. So when it came up, I just had to deal with it in that way. I said, I don't believe in this, and I won't do that. I don't work that way. And it was an episode that passed fairly quickly. But
you hear stories, people saying, oh, it happens all the time. You know, you never know. No one would ever know. Who cares? It's probably what the president would have been thinking anyways. What's your response to something like that?
Well, it doesn't happen all the time. For example, I'm around the president all day long, as we talked about at the beginning of the show, and I know what the president thinks. I take notes on what he says. There are plenty of quotes to give out to the press. The press is always asking for quotes. They always want to know, what did the president say? What are his words? And I make it my business to write those things down and to know what he said on various subjects. But it's not necessary to make up quotes. And there are times when we'll want to give a quote on a subject, and I will jot something down and go to the president and say, does this seem reasonable, or would you approve this? Or in which case he approves some language to say. But otherwise, it's just not necessary.
Has there been a time during your tenure that you've been in the dark, so to speak? I know that Larry talked about not knowing about the invasion of Grenada. He knew it like just maybe an hour before it happened. Mm-hmm. Has there been a situation like that with you?
No, there hasn't. I'm very pleased with that situation. I've had a very good relationship with all of the White House staff and with the president. I've never had a problem like that. I'm very close to Colin Powell, who's General Powell is the president's national security advisor, and Ken Duberstein, who's the president's chief of staff. And it just hasn't come up. And it shouldn't. A good press secretary should be included in everything. And sometimes you have to prove to the rest of the staff that you know how to handle information and how to deal with their policies and their programs. But that's possible. And once that's done, they'll tell you what's happening, and shouldn't be a problem.
Well, we want to find out what you do while you're in Santa Barbara, and we're going to find out right after this, so stay with us. We'll continue our conversation with Marlin Fitzwater.
Navy, it's not just a job. It's flight operations off the Hawaiian Islands. It's a missile exercise in the Caribbean. It's port of call, Hong Kong.
Let go of the anchor.
Most jobs promise you the world. The Navy delivers. See your recruiter. Navy, it's not just a job, it's an adventure.
And welcome back. This is Around the Town, and we're talking with Marlin Fitzwater, the White House spokesman. Marlin, you've been in Santa Barbara now for the last 3 or 4 years? 3 years.
Well, 6 years, actually, all total, although I had a 2-year break there when I was with Vice President Bush.
Everyone wants to know, all the Santa Barbara residents want to know, what do you do in Santa Barbara as opposed to when you're in Washington? What are some of the differences on your day-to-day routines?
Well, Santa Barbara is terrific, and the biggest difference, of course, is the weather. When you step off of that airplane out of Point Magoo Naval Air Station at 70 degrees and it's 104 in Washington, that's the big difference. But Santa Barbara is a wonderful place to be on a temporary basis or for a vacation, I'm sure, because of all the restaurants, the environment, of course, is so beautiful here with the ocean and the mountains, and there's sailing, and we go horseback riding, so there's no lack of things to do in Santa Barbara, that's for sure.
Is it the routine, though, for you in the daytime as far as when you're waking up and you're still reading the newspapers and getting meetings with your advisors and that sort?
Well, we have to work every day, but obviously it's a far more relaxed atmosphere. And normally I brief the press every morning at the hotel, and before that have staff meetings and read the papers and call Washington, find out what's going on. Very much the same routine that I have in Washington. It's just that your phone calls are long distance instead of across the White House. But usually by early afternoon, things have pretty much calmed down and everybody wants to get to the beach or some other recreation. So it's a leisurely atmosphere and one that most of us call a vacation, even whether it's not.
Had you ever been to Santa Barbara prior to your visits with the White House?
No, I never had. In fact, I'd never been to Southern California. And when I came to Santa Barbara the first time, I thought, this is heaven on earth. No wonder all these millions of people are coming out here. Then I saw L.A. and a few other places, but nevertheless, it's been a great experience here.
Well, Santa Barbara's a nice place because it's far enough from L.A., yet close enough if you have to go and do things in Los Angeles.
That's right.
When you're in Santa Barbara, however, you're saying you're doing horseback riding, going to the beach, all the fun things that most Santa Barbaras love. Would you ever consider moving here?
Well, I'd love to move here. In fact, the whole press corps, all we do all day is spend ways scheming to find new careers that'll bring us to Santa Barbara. We've had two members of the press corps, in fact, who have purchased homes here and plan to come back as soon as the Reagan administration is over or they retire, a CBS correspondent and a Washington Post correspondent.
What about after January 20th? What are some of your plans?
Well, I haven't really had a chance to think about those. We have a lot to do yet between now and November, and then on again in between November and January. And I just haven't had a chance to focus on my personal plans at the moment.
Oh, come on. You can tell us.
Well, no, this is true. Everybody says, well, the first thing you have to do is decide what you want to do. Well, asking somebody what they want to do in life is the toughest thing there is. So I think it's most likely some corporation. Public affairs, but then I might also be involved in trying to start my own company in Washington, or even academic life has some appeal to me, so I just haven't had a chance to sort it all out yet.
Do you think a book might be around the corner?
Well, I don't know. We've had kind of bad experience with books here lately. I think it might be possible to write a book. Certainly, I wouldn't mind writing one on my experiences with the press corps. I wouldn't mind writing a kind of a textbook on press relations, something along that line.
Do you read the books? Do you read the books from Donald Reagan and Larry Speaks? And
I read some of the books, right? And those two books, actually, I've read parts of them, but not all of them. But every press secretary since Kennedy's, Pierre Salinger, has written a book. And I made this point when Larry's book came out, that it certainly is possible to write a book about life in the White House without trashing your president. And indeed, there may be some historical responsibility to reflect on those events. And I think at some point I might like to write about the press and the White House and the things that went on. But it would be very flattering to Ronald Reagan, I assure you, because he's done a lot for me, and I owe a lot to him, and it's been a wonderful experience.
What is the most difficult part of your job?
I think the most difficult part is just learning. But it's also the most rewarding. One of the things that I've discovered about myself in this job is an amazing capacity to learn. And somehow it had eluded me through a college career that's somewhat less than illustrious. But I found that I can absorb an amazing amount of information in a short period of time and try to explain it to other people. And this job has pressed me to do that like no other job I've ever known and probably ever will know.
You don't study to become the press secretary to the president. How does one become one?
Well, you really just fall into it. There's no way to, you really can't apply for the job. You can't plan for it. I mean, I've been a public affairs specialist of one kind or another ever since college. I have a journalism degree, worked on some newspapers, then went to Washington, and have been in public affairs ever since. But I was at the Environmental Protection Agency in 1980. And a friend of mine called and said, would you like to come over to the Treasury Department and write the first speech for the new Treasury Secretary? Because he's kind of from Merrill Lynch, he's from New York, he doesn't know anything about Washington. I said, well, that makes us even, because I don't know anything about finance.
Then from there, what happened?
But I went, I did it, I stayed at Treasury for 2 years, and Larry Speaks called and said, I need a deputy to know something about the economy. And I said, fine, let's go. And so it's always just been one of those things. And after the 84 campaign, Vice President Bush offered me the job. And then when Larry left, President Reagan offered me the job to come back. So it a lot of it is kind of working in your career field, working in that area, and then just being there when the need arises.
The question that I was thinking about as I was driving here, we live in a very strange world, complex as it is. Back in 1981, there was the assassination attempt of the president, and Jim Brady had the accident. Does that ever cross your mind? Is that ever, when you're out with the president, any kind of I know there's a lot of security with the president, but do you ever stop and think about that?
Not really. It's like so many things, I think, when you're personally involved, you just don't believe it's going to happen to you. It's like asking someone who flies airplanes, do you think a lot about air crashes? You don't, because you just don't think that's going to happen to you. And similarly, I don't worry much about it either. We've never had an incident that has been personally threatening to me. We have a lot of arrests, a lot of people who make threats and things at events, but it's never weighed much on my mind.
Let me ask you this about Ronald Reagan. What do you really think his legacy will be, say, 20 years from now? What has he accomplished in your mind?
Well, it's a little hard to say, but I think he'll have an enormous legacy. And perhaps the overriding one is, I think in 20 years that he will be seen as a president who captured the spirit of his people as no other president did. When I think of great world leaders, for example, Churchill or de Gaulle or Sadat or others, they're men who captured the spirit of their times and the will of their people. And I think Reagan is much in that mold, that he has restored pride in America, he's restored patriotism, he's made people think about their country and what they believe in, and he has stood for some very strong ideals. And I suspect that will be the most lasting thing people will remember about him.
During these last few months in office now, is Ronald Reagan still pushing his agenda, or is he right now riding the coattails of his last 7.5 years?
Ronald Reagan will be pushing his agenda till he reaches the pearly gates. We are going to be working hard the last few months. Talked to him just briefly about what he plans to do afterwards, but I know that he wants to make speeches, he wants to travel around the country, he wants to talk about line item veto and balanced budget and the 22nd Amendment, many of the same things he's been talking about for 25 years. And I'm convinced that Ronald Reagan will be an active political player on the scene for years to come.
Many of the residents want to know, is he still going to have the ranch when he leaves office? Will that still be a place where he'll reside?
Oh, sure, yeah. Ronald Reagan wouldn't give up that ranch for love nor money. I mean, when Air Force One gets 2,000 miles away, his eyes begin to light up with the prospect of riding horses and working out on the ranch there. So it's an important part of his life, and I'm sure he'll be back in Santa Barbara quite often.
I asked you what the most difficult part of your job was. I'd like to know, what do you most enjoy about your job?
I think that I most enjoy the variety of issues that I'm involved in, and the people I meet. The working in the White House is a rare opportunity to see history in the making, to be a part of the decisions that affect all of us as Americans, to see the people who come through there and meet with the president who are people who are making America better in so many different areas, and it's just a very exciting kind of place to work. And a day is forever in the press business, which is another exciting thing, that you go in that day, you say what you have to say, and do your job, and if you blow it, you know it, the next morning you're on that evening's news, the next day you start over. So that's a very exhilarating kind of life.
So you feel that there's an accomplishment, you've done something, you come back.
You do get a direct feeling of accomplishment. Right. Of course, when you say something dumb or...
which doesn't happen often.
That also comes right back at you too, but it still is very exciting.
Okay. Well, we're going to continue our conversation. Stay with us. And in fact, right when we get back, I've got a name game that Marlin's going to take part in. So stay with us. We'll be back right after this.
This sounds dangerous.
Author Ken Carey is coming to Santa Barbara. Brilliant, insightful, he is a man of vision. Channel 19 will present two exclusive interviews with Ken. Watch the KCTV program schedule for dates and times.
Just think of all the beautiful wisdom that is being channeled through so many people today. Just think if that were present. in their day-to-day decision-making processes, in our government. What a different world this would be.
And welcome back. We're talking with Marlin Fitzwater, the spokesman for the White House. Marlin, we've got this name game, and I'm surprising you with it. You didn't know, and right now you still don't know what it's about. What I'm going to do is give you names of a few people, places, things. I'd like you to tell our audience the first thing that pops into your mind. We only have a few minutes, so
let's... All right, give it my best
shot. Okay. Well, first, President Reagan.
Warm, strong, wonderful man.
Mrs. Reagan.
A delight, aggressive, very involved in her husband's activities, a remarkable first lady.
The White House Press Corps.
That is a tough one. Because they're such a diverse group. I guess tough, demanding, always after me, penetrating.
Sam Donaldson.
Sam. Well, now, this is going to surprise you. Because my first thoughts about Sam are very kind. I like Sam. I think he's good, a good reporter. He can be a little rude and uncivil at times, but very direct and knows his business.
What about Santa Barbara?
Santa Barbara is a delight. It's the best restaurants in the world, friendly people, sunshine, and the Biltmore Hotel.
What about the ladies of Santa Barbara?
Well, the ladies here are all beautiful, but then the men are all handsome, too. That's the only bad part. Everybody here is so beautiful, I feel a little out of place, but otherwise it's a great experience.
George Bush.
George Bush, very strong man, good leader, strong convictions, and a very personal man, a friend. A kind of guy I'd want to drink beer with or go away for a weekend with.
Don Quayle. Dan Quayle, excuse
Dan
me.
Quayle. I don't know Dan very well, but I've been in meetings with him. He's a good legislator, a strong leader, young. Interesting, and I think it would be a great vice president.
Free enterprise.
Free enterprise. Well, that is the strength of Ronald Reagan. That's the philosophy that guides him, that he believes in, and he has believed in it to the point that America has believed in it, and we've had these 69 months of economic recovery because of it.
Pet peeves, our final one.
Pet peeves? Reporters that call me in the middle of the night.
Marlin, thank you so very much for being on Around the Town.
Thank you. I've enjoyed it. It's been fun.
Well, thank you. I'd like to thank all of you as well for joining us on Around the Town. I'd like to thank Walter's Limousine, of course, Marty's Pizza, Metropolitan Theater, the Savoy Theater, Maryland Free Enterprises, who did our makeup tonight, Marlin, and J.R. Nicolai, and Fanny's Flowers. And to all of you, Carrie Graffy, our director, for Marlin Fitzwater, I'm Ken Boxer saying, we'll see you around the town, hope so, real soon. Bye-bye now. And Victoria, hope you're getting well. Bye.